our next speaker. He belongs to the 1989 batch of the IPS Karnataka cadre, accomplished high degree of professionalism in wide and varied professional assignments, and finally got groomed and refined into an officer who has 360 degrees experience of all policing tasks, simultaneously maintaining his keen interest in all staff functions and a passion for usage of appropriate technology in policing at all levels and in all fields. As IGP Eastern Range, from September 12 to June 13, he handled a lot of critical issues in Ballari. Handled a counter-terrorism assignment with basic criticals of encounter intelligence, coastal security, training development of commandos, and anti-Nakshal operations. Presently, from Jan 15, he is working as ADGP in grievances and human rights wings. Ladies and gentlemen, with a huge round of applause, let's welcome Sri Sanjay Sahay on the dais.
It's my honor and privilege to be in a gathering, not being a signals engineer. First and foremost, I thank Mr. Alok Sinha, Foster Sensor Technology Private Limited India, for having invited me here to address a gathering of signal officers. People who've been stalwarts in their time have legends, become legends now. They will be icons and they will guide us for all times to come. I'm supposedly a non-technology man, making forays into technology every now and then. Sometimes I speak to signal engineers, other day I was talking to power engineers, I talk to all oil engineers. What connects me to all of you, different sectors? The speaker before me, he talked about a couple of things. How every sector of engineering is getting conversed into what I have written, a date with disruption. We are moving in an age where technology has become exponential. We are not able to fathom out the depth and pace of technology. We are all, as human beings, we are linear in nature. We can think only linear, and that is how the human mind has been thinking for last, I think, a billion years or so. Think of a situation wherein you see a lily pool which has grown, the lilies have grown around, say, 30 days. If it has grown exponentially, that is your geometric progression, on the 29th day, it was half. On 28th day, it was 1/4. 27th day, it was 1/8. 26th day, it was 1/16. And 25th day, it was 1/32. On the 25th day, you would have never realized in 5 days' time, the whole thing will be full of lilies. Fast forward, 1998, Kodak controlled 85% of the photography material market. 2001, Kodak itself became a Kodak moment. It was wiped away from the face of this earth by a technology which was invented by Kodak in 1975, that is the digital camera. So we live in this age, whether it's railway, whether it's signaling, whether it's power, whether it's governance, whether it's e-governance, whatever it might be. The only fact of life is that if you are able to manage disruption, only then you will survive. And disruption, for the first time in human history and in English language, has become a positive word. People's aspirations. You cannot hold our aspirations. We went through all what has been told in the last 1 hour. My aspiration is to move at the same speed as that of Eurorail, as of ICE, as of TGV, and as lots of other railway systems in the world, which I don't even know of. China, their best system so far is 2248 kilometers of bullet train from one end to the other, and running only 145 pairs. And the parallel, which was a generation before that, they have at 190 kilometers an hour, I think another 190 pairs. Population doesn't matter. Technology matters. It's first time in human history when we talk of abundance, We talk that everything is doable, everything is achievable. And if you have any doubts about this, you start reading from a university called Singularity University in the Silicon Valley. So we'll start with the presentation. It was just a compere type introduction of whatever I want to put forth to you guys. So it is a date with disruption. So this is it. There's some token changing. So from where we have come? 100 years, we were on some similar natures, from manual to mechanical to electrical to electronic to, and what it be. What are we running? What are we doing today? We are running a mass transportation system. That is what railways is. If you are able to move millions, and might be in the near future, even billions of us, in a very smooth manner, seamlessly dynamic, signaling being only one part of it. The whole thing moves like a seamless dynamic machine. It will not be created out of the blue. These are not inorganic, inanimate objects. I say every single project, every single technology, everything which we treat has no life, has certainly more life than a human being. It goes beyond the life of a human being. That is how it happens. We are talking about the human capital. Undeniably, human capital supposedly so far has been the best capital known to us. But as we move in the third decade of the 21st century, I think fourth or the fifth will be able to see artificial intelligence, and at least beyond our lifetime, super artificial intelligence might become a reality. The two bots, they started talking amongst themselves at an experiment in Facebook. Facebook got scared. They stopped that AI project. First time, if technology, if science, if it needs ethics, it is in artificial intelligence. Otherwise, it will go out of our hands and we will not know what is happening. Unfortunately, I'll not say this or that. I'll use a pretty vague term. Governmental regulatory mechanisms of whatever kind, private, public, whichever, they are not trying to exert their brain into things which should be guided by human beings, at least till the time we still remain in control of the technology. That might not be forever. So this is the human capital of all of you. You are the human capital. Human capital has been the driver of human history so far. But as we move further, I think even 5-10 years before the present moment, I think technology has taken over. So now you have to align to technology, not the other way around, that the technology will align to you. And for the first time in human history, governance, law, management, literally enterprise, everything is controlled by technology. It's not a management model thrown out of a Harvard Business School on which the railways can run. It will be the technology, it will be 5G, it will be IPv6, it will be Internet of Things, it would be cloud computing, it will be lots and lots of other things which will finally decide the fate of Indian Railways and also the fate of all railways across the face of the earth, and as soon as how best you align to it. Whether you are a technology or not a technology doesn't make any difference at all. At the end of the story, we have something called cyber forensic scientists. I don't know whether you have any idea as to what they do. Without raising any skepticism on the capabilities of those great scientists who bring to conclusion large number of our criminal investigation cases, what they actually do is to put a hard drive or whatever is the digital evidence equipment into a standardized machine and they get a report out of it. I can also do that. And might be emboldened by that sort of a thing which scientists have done for all of us. I also got into technology. Correct. So this is the human capital. Human capital's science technology is not going to give a new answer. And whatever you have learned in your engineering colleges and whatever you practice in whichever ecosystem you live in, unless you have a technological frame of mind, it is not going to help. You might come from engineering background. That does not make any difference whatsoever. There are lots and lots of people who are running technology on the face of this earth who are not from science or technology background. So knowledge cannot be controlled by anybody. So this is from where we start. We might give a very nice narrative of how we brought safety into railways. This is how safety came into railways. Safety did not come into railways because we designed safety into it. Safety came into railways because there were situations which warranted the political leadership, the country's leadership. There was uproar, there was a revolt. I think in the second case, the gentleman who was driving the rail, he was convicted for mass murder. So this is how things happen, this is how things change, this is how change happens in the world. So signaling over the years, it has changed from whatever it was which we saw, we know from a manual thing, to a completely computerized, non-human intervention based signaling system. Engineers of today, the gentleman before me, he was talking about that the today's engineers, they don't know what is actually happening in the signaling front. You go to any sector, it's the same story. The power engineers, they tell, oh, they have taken all the control from us. We are the operations technology. These fellows are IT, they just don't understand anything. This turf war you will not win. This turf war is only already won by IT. So it's left to you, whether you want to be a part of the mainstream or you keep cribbing that these guys don't anything. It's coding an algorithm which will decide the fate of the earth and nothing else. That's the reality of life. Face it. If you are a company into this trade, you face it. You write your algorithm and become the winner in this world. Don't come up with all those 50 years old stuff. Oh, it's like this, it's like that. Romanticism and emotions are not going to help. Let's be very, very clear about it. Signaling over the years, the Indian time lag. Is there an Indian time lag? With all the great work done, might we would have been worse off. We're not denying that. But as we stand at this point in history, is there a time lag between us and ICE and TGV and Eurorail and Bullet Train and anybody else? Do we have something on the platter? Do we have something which we can replicate? Do we have something in our hands which we can show it to the world? So this is where it is. Unconnected. There's no fault of the driver. I'm not saying there's a fault of the driver. This is not my case to say there's fault of the driver. It was not a fault of the driver. Nonetheless, can technology or would technology in any manner be helpful in avoiding tragedies of this nature? If you intend to discipline 125 crore population, it has left you. I might align to technology. Somebody else might, 10,000, 20,000, 50,000 practitioners, educated people, scientists, they also don't align to technology. Railway safety, where do we stand? I don't know where we stand. I try to find out over the internet as to where we stand in the number of accidents in different countries across the face of the globe. I have not been able to find out. But whatever we read and we hear on the TV, I think with quite a uncanny regularity, it keeps happening. And at every point in time, it is either a human failure or a signaling failure or some failure or the other or a combination of the two. I think this fish plate thing was going on for a pretty long time and I got interested into that because I think 32 or 22 of those railway accidents, it was being attributed to some other adversary country that those buggers were removing the fish plates. Be as it may be, but what was our sensor technology doing? Technology is a force multiplier. It is a facilitator, it is an enabler. It has to deliver, it is meant to deliver. It is our slave who does not ask for incentive, does not ask for dearness allowance, does not ask for EL and CL. Does not ask for leave travel concession in India or in foreign countries. So where do we stand? We can take a call ourselves as to where do we stand. In policing, in governance, might be we can do a couple of things without technology. But in technology, how can you do without technology? I have absolutely no answers. How much can technology deliver? I think this is a fair question I would like to ask you. Because in India, we have a great fancy of saying, technology can only do this much, this cannot be done, you're putting human resources this way. So it's a very, very nice and fanciful thought process and the process of articulation which you have developed over the years, where we want to demean technology. Why? Because we have not been able to get the appropriate technology, pick up the capabilities of execution, and run it in a robust manner. And technology doesn't have a voice. So you say whatever European Rail Transit Protocol or whatever, hey, it will not deliver in India. Anyway, so that is how it happens in nearly all parts of the trade in this country. I'm not very sure how much it helps, how much doesn't help. Global parameters, where's the vision? There has to be a permanence of relationship. Either you have a permanence of relationship or you have an in-house huge amount of R&D capability at the cutting edge. And as you talked about the cloud, the National Security Agency of the US handles the cloud, which is, I think, 13 exabytes. Finally, whether you want it or you don't want it, the whole world will move on to the cloud. So that is where we are. This is not my vision or anybody else's vision. This is the way it is. And in this whole scenario which I've been talking about, we also have Telemetro. World class. Mr. Sridharan. Technocrat. Leader par excellence. Least amount of inconvenience is creating a metro of that nature. I'm a layman. I'm an outsider. This is what is my feeling. The capability of a leader, engineer, scientist or otherwise is determined, decided and evaluated on his capability to deliver a project of global standards in a robust manner, in an acceptable costing and quality, in a timeline which should be one of its kind, because we have missed out somewhere in the race. You take, for example, this Jamnagar refinery. I think the best of the people in the world, they said it will take 88 to 9 years. And lo and behold, Dhirubhai Ambani made it in 34 or 36 months. It takes care of 70% of the business of Reliance and nearly the whole thing of crude and processed oil for this whole of this country. From importing country, we became an export surplus country. So here we are. So world class, we know how to create it, I think, is the purple line, 12.5 kilometers, which runs driverless. Here, right here in this country. There are lots of routes which can become driverless, depending on how we are able to elevate the signaling technology. That is the nervous system. And signaling is not directly proportional only to safety. Signaling is directly proportional to every single activity of the railways. Every single activity, and indirectly, it impacts nearly 60, 70, 80 crores of these people in nearly every activity we do, from in selling some vegetables to literally anything and everything. So we'll not go further. So this is our European train control system, which has some level 1, level 2, level 3. I tried to understand, because I got into signaling only at around 10 o'clock yesterday night. Before that, I didn't know what signaling was all about. So I thought I'm going and meeting dons and dons and legends and icons. So I should also be prepared for that. I was trying my level best to catch up with whatever knowledge you people have gathered in a lifetime. Unfortunately, I have not matched that. But okay, something I can talk on the stage right in front of you without being, what do you say, cross-examined, interrogated or whatever in the police language. So here we have the European Rail Transportation Management System and you have the control system there. These are known systems. Who will give you the know-how? Who will give you the algorithm? Who will give you the source code? Whether you watch on internet here or you go there and travel in that train, not going to come like that. Any company for that matter, whether this company, that company, whatever. See, you create a technology, you invent a technology, you discover a technology, make it commercial. For what purpose? It's a business company. They'll do business out of it. Microsoft used to generate 86.7% profits. Unimaginable. But that is how it is. Today, all top five companies in the world are IT companies. And tomorrow, there might be a company which deals with only transportation. And you're talking about signaling here, they will deal from air traffic control to submarine transportation. That is the strength and depth of IT. This nobody talks about. This is where the world is stuck up. Critical infrastructure is the primary target of hackers, state actors, non-state actors, intelligence agencies, hacktivists, all across the face of this earth. Critical infrastructure, because it is very intricately connected to national security, remains one of the prime targets. Any attack on any critical sector has a very debilitating sort of attack on the whole of the economy. It brings the country to its knees. And in that whole exercise, I think railways also fits in that scheme of things, whether it's the power, it's electricity, it's civil aviation. Unfortunately, every single system today works on either SCADA or a SCADA type system. And SCADA and SCADA type system, somewhere it has an interface with IT. And once you have an interface with IT, you remain vulnerable as ever. So cyber security, the most important factor today is resilience inbuilt. Tomorrow, see what happens. There's an accident, say of the Amritsar nature or any other nature. What do you do? There's a fixed standard protocol. You follow the protocol. Everybody is conversant. As they call in the private sector, they know that if damage happens, this happens, destruction happens, tsunami happens, any of those other calamities happen, they know what to do. In a cyber attack, they don't know what to do. Now the signaling is not going to help. But it will stop all your signals. There will be absolutely no signal. Somebody else will be controlling the whole show. And we will be watching from outside. So what are we doing? Based on this requirement, what is our response? It is not the IT guy or the cyber security fellow who has to learn signaling. It's the signaling guy who has to pick up these traits or these skills. So we have been talking about technology all the while. Why we are getting into IT and all these areas in such a big way? Because IT today is the general purpose technology. And general purpose technology literally defines technologies in all the areas. General purpose technologies drive the most economic growth because they unleash cascades of complementary innovation like light bulbs and yes, the factory design. What is the general purpose technology of today? Can you tell me? Yes, let's have some interaction before I say thank you to you guys for being an excellent audience. So, what is the general purpose technology of today? IT. Now, as long as we are stuck up with electrical and electronics and steam and all that, so you used to say, okay, it's electronics with the driver, with the electrical with the driver. In IT, it is endless. IT is just the computer which is a driver, is the computational power which is a driver, is the storage which is a driver, is the cloud which is a driver, is it IPv6 which is a driver, is it 5G, that is a driver, it's endless. Or it is the blockchain technology which is a driver. These IT has thrown a vast array of general purpose technologies and each to themselves have the capability to transform the world in an unimaginable manner. And fortunately or unfortunately, they are coming in combination. It's a very deadly combination. You will not know what has hit you. It's the Kodak sort of a thing. And by 2024, leave aside Indian Railways, it will be, which will be live and kicking in 2024. There's no doubt about it. I'm talking about the private companies. In 2024, two-thirds of the companies which will rule the world are either not born or they are so small that we don't even recognize or identify them. So this is the churning which is going to happen in next 6 years. So who do we collaborate with? We don't know. This is it. Computers, internet, IPv6, big data, machine learning, artificial intelligence, blockchain, interlink, which is a general purpose technology, which is not a general purpose technology, which country will pick up what, which enterprise will do what, which enterprise will bring a combination of things. A person like Steve Jobs, he did not invent anything. He did not discover anything. He was just an innovator. Innovator par excellence. And created products which best of the inventors never imagined in their life. And there'll be tons and tons of people who will follow that example. Tons and tons of people. And they might not be necessarily from technology. Anybody who wishes to deliver today, there is technology would be there, which engineers and scientists and researchers will say it is a black box. But for governments, policy makers and people who are not in technology, they lap it because they know at the other end of the black box is success, prosperity, abundance and the like. So data may be the new oil, but artificial intelligence is the engine that it fuels. So this is where we are. Can the analysis of humongous railway signaling data over the decades usher in better railway safety? Can it? Can it not? If you pick up all railway accidents, all railway disruptions, anything which has not happened, the smallest of the event which has not happened as per your signaling protocol, if all that data goes on an algorithm and in the nature which you people want, what will that analysis throw? Will it be equal to all the opinions, knowledge, aspirations, thought processes, concept which we as human beings and professionals have, or it will be way, way, way beyond that? Cumulative of individuals, which is a society or an enterprise, whatever you call it, the brain and the gray matter and the institutional memory is way beyond that. When you put technology into a similar manner, it will be analyzed in a way you cannot imagine. Whether you put big data on it, you put machine learning on it, whatever you put on it, you will be able, or you will find out first time in your experience that there are things which technology can do much better than any of us. We will not be able to handle, say, 1,000 fields in different permutation combination, and we are able to analyze to an extent which can even give you a connection between the eyesight, the vision at that particular point in time of the railway driver and the nature of accident which has taken place. That is the limit to which technology can take you. So what is the vision? We have been talking about lots and lots of things. What is the vision? There has to be a vision. We have to envision something. We should know where we want to go. We need a white paper today that this is where we stand, and we also need to say in 2030 we will reach this way. And this is the gap analysis, and this is the resource which we will put forth for that gap analysis on a very very tight sort of a project plan, where milestones are known, validation is known, certification is known, and we move further, and finally we deliver that this is the integrated signaling solution. Tested once, twice, three times, five times, 10 times, 20 times. The London Olympics, the whole IT system was tested only 200,000 times. The Tetra for Beijing Olympics was only tested for 2 years. It started functioning 2 years before the inauguration of the Beijing Olympics. So technology is not a magic. It is not a magical wand. You have to get the technology in the raw form. You have to process it. You have to make it functional. You have to test it. It works in an iterative process. And if you have any doubts on whatever I'm saying, leave aside any other sector. I talk in nearly all the sectors. You talk to people who have been handling those technologies as to how much time and how many years and whatever your company took to reach that particular place. There's an iterative process which slowly evolves into the final product, where the first cut or the first version of that particular system, you're in a position to roll out, and it takes a long time by the time it becomes robust. I delivered a system which is known as the police IT. We took around 8-9 years to create. And from the day of commissioning that system and the day when the government said this is the only source of crime statistics, we took only 6 years. Everything done, delivered, functioning. But that 6 years only, what we did, only one thing we did, that we were able to get rid of the disclaimer. Before that, my database had a disclaimer based on the data available. Professionals are very smart and freaky, and more these English speaking types. So they will add such sort of stuff as is all of our IT industry does. So the consent or the agreement which they have in the IT industry generally is on 4 font. And while you are doing something, it crops up. And you accept in desperation. And they say, only to read all the consent agreement or I accept whatever you do on the internet, an average American will take 74 hours or 74 days only to physically read. Leave aside, understand, which nobody has understood in this world, but for Mark Zuckerberg and all those people of that, Larry Page and all that. Because money comes out of it. No, they know how to monetize that agreement. Anyway, so this is the vision. What is the roadmap? The best of the buildings in the world, the best of the technologies in the world, they were a blueprint one day. Do we have the blueprint? Only if we have a blueprint, we move. If we don't have a blueprint, it's very, very difficult. So this is where we are. Onboarding technology partners. Either we know how to create technology, or we have to onboard partners. National Security Agency has around 8 to 10 partners. There's a company called Palantir, which has still not become public. Just $800 million, working only for anti-terrorism stuff in Afghanistan and in Iraq. But the nature of technologies which they have developed, I think, can do wonders in banking, insurance, and lots of other sectors for prediction, for correlation, for lots of other linkages which they are able to create. So until unless we have technology partners who are there for the long run, because this technology is not going to happen in one project or two projects or for, say, 6 months or 1 year, as the case may be. Technology and know-how transfer. You can buy things. Is something like the job done by the World Food Organization and Food and Agriculture Organization. The World Food Organization gives you grains when you are facing hunger. Might be because of famine or flood or whatever. So that is what the World Food Program does. Food and Agricultural Organization, FAO. FAO does not believe in that concept. It provides you skills that for all of you, all your life, you can grow grains. This is what it is. The first one is World Food Program. And this is the Food and Agricultural Organization, which provides you skills, expertise. It provides you what, kinesthetic or some learning, they call it. I was into some 9 types of intelligences yesterday. One of these intelligences is this. Your hands-on. In Singapore, they say, only hands-on is on. No PPT, no bhashna, nothing. You know it, you do it, you can deliver. That's the end of the matter. You're a professional or you're not a professional. Correct. So this is it. You have been an extremely kind audience, and you're ready to listen to a non-technologist for, I think, 20-25 minutes. It's been my pleasure and privilege and my honor to be here addressing you guys who have been legends in your own field and have brought Indian Railways to where it is, and Fossil as a company has been collaborating with them. I hope, I wish for you, for the company which has hosted me here, and for all of us Indians, that we in the near future get a railways which we deserve of. Thank you.